Well, welcome, everyone. I think everybody has met me in some of our meetings. If not, I am Larry Pope, and I work for Health Management Associates, which is the parent company for this hospital. And I've already done the basic training. Some of you have done that, and those that haven't, if you go to your cover page here and look at that website at the bottom, if you go to that website, go to training, and go to the 100 level, you will do the basic training that some of those us have already done. Maybe you haven't done that. So you can do it online. This is a certificate online you can print out, bring here to Robin and to the hospital, and let them know that you've already done that training and get started. And there's the other steps to go through. Become a volunteer chaplain, the little things we need to do that all employees and all volunteers who do patient contact need to do, be up and ready. So thank you for coming. A great group. I really didn't expect this many. Usually the group kind of narrows down because some of the local ministers say, I don't really need to understand about how to answer code blue. I won't be doing that. Or how to remove life support. I won't be doing that. It is open to everyone so that they can learn, because we will be involved in these end-of-life issues even with ourselves, if not at least with our family members. So if you've got anybody in your family that's going to be ill or sick or even in the process of dying, you will gain information and you will be a little smarter being able to help them in that. So I'm glad you're here today. Let's begin our day with prayer. We probably all of us blessed our food individually. Let's bless this day. Father, thank you for being here. We thank you that this ministry is all about you. We care about your people, the ones you care for, those that are sick, those that are hurting, those that are afraid. And we want to be ministers of peace to them. Thank you that you've ordained this day and these people to become part of this group. Thank you for all that you're doing in our lives to help us to serve. We ask that our minds would be sharp this day as we want to learn, we want to grow. So thank you for being a part of our day and blessing this meal and blessing all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's get started on these. Let me set up this PowerPoint for the next section. So the first part we will do today is the 201 end-of-life issues. Many times and most times when you go and do hospital ministry, the patients are going to get better. Prayer works. We haven't experienced that. You will experience that in this ministry, that God does some great things. He does some miracles, large ones and small ones. Tell that example. That's a good one, Paul.
4 weeks ago, coming Sunday, we go to the Wesleyan Church, and Pastor Mull said, I'm going to do something which I don't usually do. It's not a kneeling church. He said, I'd like to ask everybody that can get down, kneel. And he said a prayer. And what I have a knee problem. I've had it since I was a kid. My wife just had her knee replaced, and so she's on the mend. And it's not going as well as she would hope. So I told her, I says, you know, you're going to have to get well pretty soon because my knee is getting worse. But when I got down, it was painful getting down. But when he said amen, and I rose, 4 weeks I have had no pain in that knee.
Thank you, Lord.
No pain at all.
Great. That's just a little late. He said, oh, I didn't pray for that one. That was just extra grace.
No, it was a benefit. I don't pray for myself. He's so good to me, I don't dare ask for any more.
I'm going to be adding to my website something I haven't done before, and that is a little section on answers to prayer. So I'm asking all of my chaplain, all the volunteers to send in to me, send to my email, answers to prayer, and I'm going to put them on the website. Because sometimes we get that feeling, is God doing anything? You know, I keep praying and praying, and my patients aren't getting better, I'm not getting better. It will be encouragement, I think, to us all. So many times in your chaplaincy ministry, patients are going to get better. But at times, all of us meet our maker, don't we? All of us have that moment when we do get sick, and there's the perfect healing of heaven, right? The perfect miracle of heaven. We forget that that's a miracle. That's a healing. Your body never gets sick again after that. But sometime we look maybe as ministry as, wow, that's a little burdensome. People get sick and they die. In fact, when I introduce myself sometime as a chaplain, they go, oh, I'm so sorry. You know, well, don't feel sorry, you know. No. Most of the time my ministry is very happy. People get better, you know. But at times it can be burdensome. And so we're going to talk about that element today of ministry that can be sad. But it may be also something that God has gifted you for that in some way you kind of come alive at that moment. How hospice nurses and hospice chaplains go, it's just my element. It's just what I do best. So you may find that in those times of end-of-life issues, you may find God using you in a special way. So we're going to talk about those times today, when patients don't get better. They are holy moments that I see, times when I see God doing his best work. And sometimes I think it's times when God gets our attention, when we make some big changes in life. And even in that holy moment when they take their last breath, I think that is a holy time when we see them going into eternity, going into the presence of God. How sometimes wonderful and sometimes scary that can be according to their preparedness, but I still see all those as holy moments. We're going to talk about today advanced directives. These terms are sometimes interchangeable with the word living will or healthcare surrogate organ donation. So if you look at advanced directive, it is the umbrella of three things under it. So if you use them interchangeably, it means the same thing. If someone asks, do you have a living will or do you have an advanced directive? Okay, you'll understand what they mean. But the title of advanced directive includes these three things of the living will, the healthcare surrogate. The word proxy is simply a word that is appointed by the court. So if the court appoints someone to be a surrogate, it will be called proxy and organ donation. Advanced directives, let's see what they're not, because this gets confusing. Someone may say, I don't want to fit on an advance directive. I want all my money to go to my son and my house and husband. I'm not talking about your money. I'm not talking about your last will and testament. I'm talking about your decisions for health care. So the advance directives just talk about health care, where your last will and testament may talk about your money, your belongings, and those kind of things. It is also not a power of attorney for banking. Florida law and many other states separate the two. So that if you want someone to be in charge of your banking and writing checks and those kind of things, you need to fill out the other form, the power of attorney. So, and you might go to Office Depot or Staples and get that blank form and get that notarized, and that's not, or go to visit your attorney. Same thing is true for the advance directives. You may visit your attorney and do those there. They really are no better than the other. Even if you wrote them on a napkin and signed them and had two people witness it, it's done. It's an advance directive. Okay? But you might find a free one in any hospital, and you might find one for $5 or so at Office Depot or Staples, or you might go visit an attorney and get them to write it up for you, however you feel comfortable. Filing this advance directive is important too. I wouldn't put my master copy, my advance directive, in my safety deposit box, because no one can get to it. I may have appointed a power of attorney to get to it, but I might keep it a little more accessible, okay? But I would also make copies of that for everybody that's involved, those of my family members, especially for my surrogates. Now, the word surrogate means if I am a patient and I'm writing out my advance directive, my surrogates are the ones that are going to speak for me when I can't. So my wife, Sarah, and my daughter, Lori, are my surrogates, okay? Anybody can be a surrogate, okay, as far as only one blood member can be that. But, anybody can be a surrogate, but only one blood member can witness that. So I might choose a neighbor, a friend, or whoever to be a surrogate. It doesn't have to be family, but it's somebody that knows me, somebody that's going to follow my wishes in that. And then I would give a copy to my physicians. When we're healthy, we might just have one doctor. We might just go for an annual visit to our family doctor, and we might just have one. But when we're ill, very sick, we might have 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 doctors. During those moments, I would give a copy to all of those doctors. But in this time of, we all think we're well, doing fine now, I will give it to that one doctor that's taking care of us now and have it in some kind of safekeeping, but keep it accessible. Who can witness this? Anybody over the age of 18 can witness this advanced directive. But in many states, and here's where it breaks down, every state's a little bit different. So I'm going to talk about Florida since you're here, and I'm going to make some examples of other states, because sometimes we're not only here, we travel and we're in other states. So in Florida and most states, it's over 18 to be a witness. It would not be the surrogate. So again, my wife Sarah, my daughter Lori, or my surrogates, they can't witness my living will. Okay? It would be kind of a conflict of interest. They're the ones that are going to be speaking for me, so they wouldn't be documenting that I signed. And then some states say not blood relatives. Now in Florida, they say one person can be a blood relative who witnessed, but not two. Most states say nobody as a blood relative can witness. So you find out what state yours is in. And I would encourage you all, if you are snowbirds or travel or in different states, get one done in both states, just to be sure that you're following those state guidelines. It is not like a driver's license. You only get one and you relinquish it as you move to the next state. You may have two. And things may be a little different in that state, and keeping that with you when you travel. And some states say no hospital staff can witness the living will. They say maybe a conflict of interest in that. Now, Florida does not have that rule. Florida allows staff, employees, like a nurse, doctor, whatever, to witness the living will. But they do not allow us to witness those kind of things that deal with banking, like the power of attorney or last will and testament. So if that's being done, no, can't do that. But as far as the advance directive, we and then the state of Florida looks at it, it is in our best interest and the patient's best interest to get this done. It is not a conflict of interest of us carrying out that advance directive. So it behooves us to help them get that done. Witnesses are verifying, first of all, the signature. So let's say you're a volunteer chaplain and you're walking to a room and you see someone filling out their advance directive and they say, would you like to be a witness? Sure, I don't mind being a witness. So what I might do is I'm watching the person sign. Now, sometimes they have it already signed and you walk in the room and they're going, oh, would you be a witness? Again, it's like this is not a document about banking and money, but I might say, sir, did you sign this? Yes, I did. Oh, okay, I'll witness it. Because you're verifying the person understands that. That's kind of the main thing. You go, do you understand what you're signing? I might ask that and say, sir, do you understand what you're signing? Tell me what you're signing here. They, oh yeah, this is for my money to go to my kid. No, this is what is it about? What were we talking about? Oh, that advanced directive thing. And what is that good for? Talking about what I want and don't want about life support. Oh, okay. So it's kind of that thing, you kind of know the patient knows what they're signing and knows what's going on. Here's what happens many, many times. The patient's very, very elderly, very, very sick, and they've never filled that one. And here comes that moment, we need to get Grandpa to sign this thing, and if we don't, he's going to slip into a coma and he won't be able to have an advance directive, so we need to get it signed now. But everybody knows he's not alert and he doesn't really know what he's signing. They go, it's got to be done. Well, it should have been done 40 years ago. But it's not done now. And so we will carry out the advance directives properly in his behalf. But he can't sign one now. Now, it may be a time when he's out of this coma, out of this fogginess, so that maybe tomorrow it's okay and he can sign it. So we shouldn't need to wait till then. So sometimes the nurse verifies, is this a good time to sign or not? I, as a layperson, I'm not medical, and I don't really know of perfect alertness of what a patient should be. But the nurse might know, well, this patient is anoxic and has had low oxygen and wouldn't be able to think clearly. So no, don't sign now. Well, the nurse might know that, but I wouldn't know that. So I might many times go ask the nurse, is this a good time for this patient to sign? Especially when we're curious. And it may be that the patient just came back from surgery, is on some kind of anesthesia, that it would make it legal for them to sign, because we know that they're not completely competent. So there are certain times when we just simply ask the nurse, is this a good time? And then we, as a volunteer chaplain, can witness the living will and encourage them to do that. And many, in the admitting department, every admitting department has blank living wills if you need to go get someone there, they have them there in that department. Let me stop and say this. What I'm going to be training this morning is a lot more technical than we did in the last time, a lot more medical, a lot more of what goes on behind the scenes that most, even sometimes most chaplains don't understand. But I want to get you comfortable here on this turf in this hospital so that you understand what's going on. Because you might not be the educator of how to do advanced directives, but at least you'll understand. And I don't want you to become the educator. I want to go, well, Larry told me this, and but, you know, it's kind of like, well, let's go ask the nurse, let's go ask the doctor. But I want you comfortable in this arena so that when things are going on and end-of-life issues, we will be talking a lot with the patient about advanced directives and other things. So I just want to get you comfortable with this turf. The surrogate's job, the job of the surrogate is to speak for the patient. Here's where it goes bad. When I, as a doctor, walk up to you as a family member and say, okay, George is in the bed, what do you want me to do for him? And you tell me, I am a doctor responsible because I asked you the question. It's the wrong question. It is not, what do you, the family member, want to do with George? It is, what did George tell us to do? Did he have an advanced directive? Oh, well, let's read it then. Word by word, this is what George wants us to do. Did George tell us anything personal, anything added to that verbally? Okay, that's what we need to do. But if I ask you, what is the family, or we have a family vote, what do you all want me to do? Because most doctors are afraid of the litigation. The living can sue me, the dead can't. So they're like, well, let me see what they want me to do to be sure I'm doing the right thing. It's the wrong question. So even if you, as a patient or family member, get asked that question by a doctor, you go, no, it's not what the family wants, it's what the patient wants. Okay? And the same thing, with, you may have said sometimes, I've seen where advanced directives weren't followed. They wrote them down explicitly and the doctors did what they wanted to. It's because of that question. They asked the wrong question. What do you want us to do, rather than what did they tell us to do? So we're all carrying this back, and this is what Joint Commission states, is what ACA states, which is the overseer of state of Florida, looks at hospitals. Patient rights, patient wishes. What does the patient want? And we can skirt around that sometime by some questions that can not get to the point. So let's talk about what it means, just the basic words, advanced directives. Directives in advance. You notice that there's not a D after that word, advanced directives. It's advanced directives, okay? Sometimes we spell it wrong, and therefore we understand it wrong. It is directives made in advance. In advance of what? Why would I take this time to write down on a piece of paper my directives in advance of what? In advance of my cardiac arrest, my pulmonary arrest, my electrocution, my drowning, my car accident, my stroke, my aneurysm. Man, I'm getting really sad today. This is really hard, heavy stuff. But I don't know what might happen to me someday, so I'm making an advance directive for my family to follow that just in case these things happen. I could stand every brilliant doctor in front of us today and say, all right, guys, all right, gals, you know all about medical science. How will you die? I don't know. Someone may have stage 4 cancer, but die in a car accident. You know, someone may think they're the tip-top of shape and all of a sudden collapse with an aneurysm. I've seen that happen to a 37-year-old nurse sitting in an advanced directive seminar. Don't be afraid. But she was in an advanced directive seminar, collapsed, 37 years old, put her on life support, was an organ donor, gave her organs to science, and her family removed life support. 37 years old. We never know. I have a 37-year-old friend that just this past year died of stage 4 melanoma cancer. You know, do we know? Do we know that time when something may hit us? I don't know, but I've got my advance directive so my family knows what I want. So in advance of these things, I'm making that decision. Now, my wife and I tease each other about disagreeing on our advance directives. She's a nurse. I'm a hospital chaplain. I've worked in hospitals a lot. I've seen these kind of sad moments. I have written my advance directives and given her explicit instructions, and hers are quite different than mine. Mine is never let me suffer, never let me be on life support prolonged. And hers is do everything you can. I think she's afraid maybe I'm going to pull the plug and get married in 3 months. She's even said, I think you're just going to pull the plug and get married in 3 months. Of course, I get into trouble when I go, why would it take me 3 months? So because of smart aleck remarks like that, I think she's going to leave me on life support and let me suffer. Okay? Teasingly, we do look at our advance directives differently. And you are going to disagree, maybe with your spouse or maybe someone else. How about if you're in a patient's room and you have made up your mind what you want about life support, and they disagree as the patient, and they are leaning another way? It's none of your business. But I see nurses and doctors and chaplains and a lot of staff members giving their opinions, or even giving their opinion in the hallway in secret. Well, I don't think we ought to be doing that. And I say, it's none of your business.
That's right.
And I'm glad you've made up your mind, and I'm glad you've documented yours, and I'm glad you know what you want. But when that patient has gotten all the information they need to make their choices, and they've made this choice, and I say, well, all right, even. And I think we need to learn that posture, because if we don't, we, in somehow, they kind of sense where we're pushing things, okay? Nurses can do that, doctors can do that. We as chaplains can come in and just kind of push things a little our way. So as we give information and as we help them get information, we need, because sometimes there's this 95-year-old lady and she's going to surgery and we're going, why are they doing surgery on a 95-year-old lady? Because she wants it. Simple as that. Or why is that 60-year-old man giving up now? Because he wants to. Okay? Patient rights. Well, they get the right to choose. And this is that declaration that the state of Florida has laid and all other states have laid. Patients don't have to do anything they don't want them to. They don't have to be admitted here if they don't want to. They don't have to take the Tylenol if they don't want to. They don't have to do the surgery if they don't want to. And they don't have to do the life support if they don't want to. It's all of our patient rights. So in that making a decision, having that right, I need to write this down somewhere. I need to put it into writing so they know what I want. Here is this thing in balance. We have all of this technology out there to do all of this treatment. And I have my patient rights. Just think a short 40, 50 years ago, before they figured out how to do chest compressions on patients to get the blood flowing again, before they figured out how to do the intubation, putting a tube down your throat and breathing down your, not just the blowing in your mouth, but I mean a tube down your throat and then putting you on a machine that they're breathing for you long term, before they figured out how to take these paddles and shock your heart, before they figured out how to take this a dosage of medicine and put it in your arm or put it straight into your heart and the adrenaline that it pumps the heart gets that going. Before all of that technology, when your heart and lungs stopped, it was just, well, what else do we do? But now we can do a lot. And we're getting really, really good at it. And we're helping patients revive even that are very sickly. And we're keeping them on life support and do it a long time. The question is, how long do you want it? You want it, you want it, you want it, you want it. So if you don't tell us, we as medical science people have to err on the side of doing too much rather than too little. We have to keep trying and keep trying and keep trying until someone says, mm-mm, that's enough, thank you. Because the litigation says if you make a mistake, if you don't do enough or you're neglecting, you hear that on the nightly news, don't you? All these attorneys, you know? Do you hear on the nightly news if your doctor, if you don't want surgery and your doctor is pushing it on you, call us? Now that's illegal too. It's called medical malpractice. It's called medical assault and battery. That's illegal if they push something you don't want. But you don't hear that or not. You hear, they missed something. They should have caught this. Okay? So everybody's running scared, trying to do too much rather than too little. So that's why we get in these traps sometime of seeing the patient on life support, taking care of those needs. Maybe when all of us are scratching our head going, why? I don't understand it. I don't know why we're pushing this step. But it's because we have the ability. And I don't think we're done yet with medical science. In fact, that's one of the key areas where they're advancing is in the emergency room. More things that they're learning. So we're going to get better and better and better. There's really only, I would say, one person, one kind of person that does not need an advanced directive. It's the person that is so far away from the ambulance and 911 and anybody that knows how to do CPR that when they finally get there and they do CPR, it doesn't work. That's the only kind of person that doesn't need an advanced directive. Now, most of the time, you're around someone that knows a little bit of CPR, knows how to call 911, and they get there in a few minutes. And then they're going to get revived, and then they're going to take you to the ER, and then they're going to take you to the ICU, and then they're going to keep you on life support. And then somebody's got to go, have they made their determination? Do they have an advanced directive? We can't help them. They're not getting any better. So what do we do now? So it's in that case, 99.9% of us are going to need an advanced directive. So every now and then, there's a guy on the golf course, and he collapses, and they try, and there's no hope. But that's rare. So for most of us, the majority is we're going to need some documentation, advanced directive. As volunteer chaplains, you will not be looking in the chart. You will not be reading the chart. You will not be opening the chart. But I want to tell you some things about what the chart says. I, as a hospital chaplain, was also wearing a different hat of patient advocate, where it was my job to read the charts every day. My job to know when the situation was looking hopeless. It was my job to confront the doctors and the case managers and the nurses and respiratory therapists to see if we're getting toward that end-of-life issue. So is it now time to talk to the family, talk to the patient, talk to the doctor, talk to the nurse about is it time to let go? Let me tell you a little bit of what we hear doctors saying verbally to patients and to family members. We hear these main three words. Now, I'm hoping when I get sick, the word's going to be, Larry's getting better, okay? But there's going to be a time in my life where the doctors are going to come to my wife and my daughter and say, the diagnosis is poor or guarded or grim. Now, I don't know what those words mean, nor do the doctors know what they mean. If I stood 50 doctors in front of you, what does grim mean? You'd get 50 answers, maybe 51 answers, okay? If you ask any of those questions, it's kind of, I don't know, I'm not God, I can't tell you for sure. So we get some of these determining charting words, maybe poor, guarded, or grim. But here are the four words that the state of Florida says need to be defined at the end of life as we're talking about letting go, the word pulling the plug that we use, to talk about removing life support. The terms are terminal, end stage, persistent vegetative state, and brain death. Now, my wife already thinks I'm brain dead, but I'm really not quite. I'm coming. I'm getting closer there. Folks, we've got to make this funny today, because this can be quite burdensome. So hang with me. I've got to find to pull out as much as I can to make this a little lighthearted, okay? The word terminal sounds really, really bad. But it's the best of those four, okay? In the category of poor prognosis, I would rather be terminal than end stage. I would rather be end stage than persistent vegetative state, and I would rather be persistent vegetative state than brain dead, like my wife said. Now note, please, New Jersey is not the persistent vegetative state. It's the garden state. Okay, we've got to have fun with this, folks. Let's define terminal. Remember I said we're going to get a little bit more technical, a little bit more medical today, maybe a little bit even more than you would do in any discussion with your family and your patients. But let's understand these terms. Terminal means no reasonable medical probability of recovery and which without treatment can be expected to cause death. Now let's say I am insulin dependent. Let's say without that, I couldn't live. And let's say I was out in a third world country in Bongo Bongo and I couldn't get to my insulin. They might determine me terminal. But if I were here in the hospital or in the US, I can get insulin, okay? It's available for me. But what if one day I said, I'm tired of taking that insulin, I don't want it anymore. Take it away. I don't want it. I'm not taking it. They may go, well, Larry, you're going to die. I don't care. They may write my chart terminal. But only because without treatment, there's treatment available. But I might refuse it, or I might not be able to get to it. So that would cause me to be terminal, even in that simple definition of without treatment. End stage is worse, where it is severe, that's a different word, and permanent deterioration indicated by incapacity and complete physical dependency, and for which to a reasonable degree of medical certainty, treatment of the irreversible condition would be medically ineffective. Take a picture here of the ICU patient, the grandma on the bed. We've been treating her not only for days but for weeks in the ICU. We've tried everything, every kind of treatment, and she's not getting better. She's not yet persistent vegetative state. She may be in and out of consciousness, but she is in a state where it may be fixable, may not be fixable, a little gray area, but the doctor's determining, well, we've tried everything. And this would be that first stage where we first start talking about in the hospital about removing life support. When a patient is terminal and treatable, we're not coming to them and go, hey, you still want more? You just take it for granted they want more. They come to the hospital, they want treatment. Well, in the end stage area is when we start talking about, well, is it time to talk to the patient, talk to the family about, do you still want more? Time about honesty. Time about, I don't know for sure, but I think maybe. And what do you want with this to move on? And it may be that time when physicians aren't talking about it, and somebody should talk about it. It may be the time when families don't want to talk about it, but should talk about it. So it is in the gray area, and sometimes patients get better in this area, so it's not for certain, but it's time to talk. The persistent vegetative state means a permanent and irreversible condition of unconsciousness in which there is the absence of voluntary action or cognitive behavior of any kind, and an inability to communicate or interact purposely with the environment. Get this picture. Here, you, the volunteer chaplain, is standing beside the bed. The family's there also. The daughter just came in from California, and 30 times she said, Mom, move your little finger. And the 30th time, she did. She goes, look, she heard me. Well, is it involuntary? Is it purposeful? Did she mean to? Because a body that is in persistent vegetative state still moves, still winces, still frowns, still might make moans, still moves their body around. But is it purposeful? Do they mean to? When I say, you know, wink your eyes twice, when I say squeeze my hand and they squeeze it once, do they mean to? So that's the question in this state about involuntary, do they have that capacity to do that? The last state is brain death, which is very rare, and the state where proven by two EEGs there was no brain activity. Little probes they would put on your head, and there would be no brain waves in the brain or brainstem. Many times there may be a patient who has had severe trauma to the brain, but there's not brain death. There is some activity, so it wouldn't be categorized as brain death. We'll talk about it in a moment about organ donation and how this used to be the main criteria for organ donation, that the patient was brain dead. So again, we're going to clear that up again about how that works with organ donation. Any questions about those four before we move on? Those four categories. And stop me if there's any questions as we move along. All right, let's talk about with or without a living will. Grandpa comes to the ER, and he has a living will in his back pocket, and the living will states those four things. If Grandpa ever gets terminal, end stage, persistent vegetative state, or brain dead, then remove life support. So they're going, why did you put life support on Grandpa? Everybody knows he's end stage, but he wants to come to the ER, but everybody knows he's end stage. His living will said end stage. And then we pull out the living will and go, well, let's read the rest. It said, if Grandpa was terminal, end stage, persistent vegetative state, or brain death, and to physician state that there's no hope. And that's layman's term, because they may use reasonable recovery term. So when those come together, the definition, the diagnosis, and to physicians, and the surrogates ready, that's when it's time to remove life support or to at least follow the living will. So if we aren't there yet, the living will says, very simply, do everything you can, put them on life support, treat them until two physicians state that there's no reason for recovery. And if you have one physician but not two, then we're not there yet. If you have five doctors and two of them are ready and three of them aren't, we might be ready. But it just simply states one of those definitions of prognosis and then the two physicians and then, of course, the surrogates, the one speaking for that patient saying it's time. When all that comes together, then that is the moment when the discussion will start about at least do not resuscitate orders and removal of life support. So when do we remove life support? When there's a poor condition, two physicians are ready, and the surrogate's ready. Let's talk about nutrition and hydration, which is the curious matter and mostly misunderstood in the advanced directive. When healthy people are filling out their advanced directive and they get to that questionnaire, do you want nutrition and hydration? The healthy person signing their advanced directive goes, what are you going to starve me? What do you mean, do I want nutrition and hydration? Of course I want nutrition. You go, wait. We're talking about only the time when nutrition and hydration isn't going to work. Get this, folks. Every possible time, if a patient can't eat, we're going to feed them. And even if the patient can't eat from the food tray, then we're going to give them some other ways to eat. So we're not talking about the food tray is in your room and they've just said you're terminal, we're not going to bring your food tray anymore. Or we're not saying the food tray is there, we're not going to feed you. If you can eat, we're going to feed you, because that's how we know patients get better, right? So even if you're not eating from your food tray, we have three other ways to feed. One is the NG tube, nasal gastric tube, that goes down your nose into your stomach, and we feed you stuff like Ensure. And sometimes it is the name brand Ensure. Same stuff you get at Walmart, just put down the tube, and it feeds you. Because you might not be swallowing, or you might have a problem swallowing it and going down into your lungs, so we feed you that way, and you get your nutrition. That's a heroic feeding. It's not normally eating from the food tray, but it's one way to feed. The other is the PEG tube, a small incision in the stomach where that same kind of Ensure goes through a tube, but directly to the stomach, not through the nose, down to the stomach. And now the question is, I've heard if you put one of those PEG tubes in and they can never take it out. That's not true. You can take it out, but you wouldn't take it out if they're not eating yet. So yes, that patient may be on a feeding tube a long time because they're not eating yet. And it may be forever with that patient. But if they start digesting again or eating again or swallowing again, yes, that can be removed and quite easily. And there's a third way that we can feed a patient. Let's suppose the gut, the stomach's not working. For some reason, it's not digesting, or maybe you had stomach surgery. And feeding you from food, even through the nasal gastric or the PEG tube, wouldn't work. There still is a way through the TPN, which is an IV of food. It's thin food. It's not as great of food. Of course, even the Ensure is not as great as a steak, in my opinion. Okay, but the TPN is not as great as the Ensure. But it is food. It is nutrition that they can give patients through an IV. So we are going to feed patients every way we possibly can until the patient might say, I don't want this anymore. Or the family might say, what's the point? They're going to die anyway. And really to feed them might just prolong things. So that discussion is very, very rare. Where again, we're usually erring on the side of doing too much rather than too little. Hospice tells us there are some moments when a patient's body is letting go and shutting down that they aren't hungry. And the digestion isn't working. They aren't running around the bed. They aren't wanting three meals like we are. So they aren't hungry. And to feed a body that isn't digesting, where's it going to go? Okay? Just bloating. So they may, in that time, it may even cause more suffering for some patients who aren't digesting. But understand, in signing that advanced directive, you're not taking away your right to nutrition. Is only rare situations and where they're going to remove that nutrition or not do that nutrition. And many times it's the day of removal of life support for the sake of the family. They're probably only going to live a few minutes, a few hours, a few days. We could feed them if you want us to, or we could not. It might just prolong death even longer. What do you want us to do? That's usually the only time that nutrition and hydration comes up. Now let's talk about what if there is no advanced directive, which happens a lot. Even though we talk a lot about advanced directives and a lot more people have them these days, there's still a bunch who don't have advanced directive. I, as a chaplain, have been by the bedside many times where a family has not made a decision or a patient hasn't made a decision. The family has to, oh no, I wish they'd told us what they wanted. You know, just, you know, pop, you know, what do you want about this? They were just like, oh, you know what I want. You know, you'll carry out my wishes. Well, what are they? You don't talk about it, you know. And when is the great time to talk about advanced directives? Is it the family's all together for Thanksgiving and you get down to the turkey and you push back from the table and go, kids, let's talk about my advanced directive. They go, Dad, you're going to live forever. Don't talk about that. When is the good time? There is no good time. But you got to talk about what you wish. And maybe a good time to just get that piece of paper out and get it all done and all signed and say, family, here's what I want. I want you to follow that. There's no question about it. There will be no vote. There will be no discussion in the family. This is what I want. Just follow that and it'll be simple. So in that moment, when there is no advance directive, nothing's been written, nothing's been signed, nothing's been discussed, here's what the state of Florida and other states will do. They will have a certain list of going down the list, seeing who is available to be the spokesperson for this patient. There's no documentation. But somebody needs to make this determination. Somebody needs to sign withdrawal. They will ask first, is there a guardian? That means in a court-appointed person. Sometimes that's done for a psych patient or an elderly patient where they have a guardian appointed. Could be family member or not, but a guardian appointed. So if there is none, we keep going down the list. Is there a legal spouse? In Florida, there is no common law marriage. There are a lot of people in Florida who live together. For tax purposes, they don't get married. And that person knows them best. But they aren't the legal spouse. So we ask, ma'am, are you his legal spouse? Well, no, but I've been together 30 years. I know that. But are you his legal spouse? No. We'll keep you in the loop and we'll give you information, but you can't sign withdrawal of life support. So are there children? Or is there a legal spouse out there that he is not divorced from yet? And that happens too. So we go contact that unengaged person that is the legal spouse and ask them, do you want to keep your right of making decisions for him, yes or no? And they can relinquish that right and push it down the list. But they still may take that right because they have that right. So then we go to the majority of children. And then we go to parents and siblings and relatives of any kind, and then even to a close friend. There are times in every state where there's a person that has burned bridges in their life. They may have family, but when they come in to go, next of kin, no, don't contact them. So we can't. So we don't know who next of kin is. And so we're like hands are tied, but they may have a best buddy, best friend, comes in the hospital, visit them. And when they come in one day and go, well, we need to make decisions about removal of life support. We've looked all down the list. Would you mind being the best friend who speaks for him, remove life support? And they can sign a best friend affidavit form and make that decision. Florida is the only state that does this last one. Then they only started that a few years ago. We have so many transient people here in Florida with no connections, maybe even under the bridge type people, and they're on life support, and hospitals cannot just remove life support because they think it's the right thing. They cannot send them to a nursing home because they're just done with them. That's illegal dumping. So you have to keep them in the ICU, you have to keep them on life support, and we're talking about not only thousands, but millions of dollars. Hospice will tell you in the last month of your life, you will spend more on medical dollars in that last month of your life than all of your life. So it's a lot of money that's taking care of that, and we had a lot of patients on life support. We simply had to take care of them. We had to do the right thing, and the right thing is do everything you can. So they finally said, okay, if you can get a social worker, they can't be paid by your hospital. They come in free of charge from another institution, and they work with your ethics committee to decide whether it's the right thing to take this patient off life support. If they come in and do that, say it's the right thing, then it's okay. You can take that patient off life support. That just started, I think, maybe 3 years ago. Other states haven't even followed suit with that. So there's a lot of medical bucks that could be, and even medicine and those kind of things, could be spent on other people who could get better, who was being being cared for by patients who could not survive, futile medicine. So the DNR or DNRO, do not resuscitate order, is a different piece of paper that you will sign. Look in this packet here, do you see your living will? And I don't know, did you put a DNRO in the packet? Mm-hmm. You have one? Everybody have one? I don't have one in mine. But do you have one? It may be stapled to the back. Yes, it is. On the living will packet, the last two pages are the do not resuscitate order. Understand that the living will advance directive is different than the DNR. The living will states again, I want life support, I want treatment, I want to evaluate how I'm doing, and when two doctors state that I can't improve, then take off life support. The DNR says, don't ever do life support. Treat me, take care of me, but if my heart stops, my lung stops, I'm dead, then don't revive me. Okay? Big distinction and big problems in understanding of the advanced directives. So is any questions with that? Because sometimes that is quite curious and unclear what those two mean. I've even had nurses say this. Why are we taking that DNR to surgery? Sometimes we use that acronym talking about patients who are do not resuscitate old. Why are we taking her to surgery? Because she wants surgery. She just doesn't want life support. So a DNR patient can say, take me to the doctor, take me to the ER, take me to the hospital. I want to do this surgery. I want to do this treatment. I want to do this chemo. I want to do this medicine. But if I die, let me go. So DNR does not mean don't treat me. It just means don't resuscitate me. So let's say I'm a patient in the room, a nurse is taking care of me, and my heart starts doing weird things. Does she pull up a chair and wait till I die?
No.
No, she treats me because I came for treatment. But if she came in the room and I'm blue, if I'm not breathing, my heart's not beating, she goes, well, Larry wanted a DNR, and I'm not going to call a code blue, and I'm not going to resuscitate her. Okay? But if I came for treatment, I came for treatment. But not wanting to be treated is another whole category of hospice, okay? So that means you can have a DNR and still want aggressive care. It means you can still want to be treated. We had a patient with DNR tattooed on his chest. I hear a lot of nurses say, I'm going to get DNR tattooed on my chest so they never resuscitate me. We actually had a patient with DNR tattooed on his chest. We didn't know it when he first came in. And on a Saturday, the man coded, opened up his shirt, and there was DNR tattooed on his chest. And the nurses called the doctor because he did not have a DNR code status on his patient file. So he was what we call a full code, meaning do everything. And so they started CPR, but they were calling the doctor, what does this DNR mean? Well, they couldn't get a hold of the doctor. I was a patient advocate, and they called me on a Saturday, Larry, what should we do? We can't get a hold of the doctor. And I said, I hope you're doing CPR. Yes, we are, because he's full code. But DNR, what does that mean? Well, I kidded them the next day coming in on Monday. I go, what if it was his girlfriend's initials? You know? But they revived the man, he survived, and they go, what's this DNR in your chest? He goes, oh, I was a military pilot, and I thought if I ever got shot down, just let me go. But thank you for resuscitating me. You know, he survived. He had some heart problem, he survived. So I say to them, okay, if you ever really want DNR tattooed on your chest, bring the doctor with you to the tattoo specialist to sign it. Because it's no good without a signature. In fact, the state of Florida, folks, says this special form here is not correct. You know why? It needs to be yellow.
Really?
If you were to put it in blue or green or white, it's not honored. It needs to be taken to a copier that has some yellow paper, and you can put in there copying that, okay? That makes it good. Here's why. EMS going into someone's home looking for this above the bed, on the refrigerator, looking for yellow paper. They're not looking for a white, you know, your children scribbled on this, your grandchild put this on your refrigerator. They're looking to see if this patient wants to be resuscitated. They're unconscious. There may be no one else to speak for this patient. The last words were, "Help!" Okay? And then we came and we're looking for, should I resuscitate this patient or not? If I don't see a yellow piece of paper as a 911 person, I do my job. I resuscitate. And even the Florida law goes this far. You see the little bottom part? The little tiny print? They say fold it, laminate it, put a hole through it, wear it around your neck. If you collapse and you're alone and you don't want to be resuscitated and they open your shirt and this is hanging there, they won't resuscitate you. But if it's not hanging there, they will resuscitate you. Because they're not going to look in your purse and they're not going to look in your wallet. They're going to follow Florida protocol. Okay? Now, I know that California uses the DNR bracelet, but Florida doesn't. They might think to look in your wallet, but they're not supposed to look in your wallet. Okay? So if you are some DNR patients drive, or someone else drives them to Walmart or church, and there they are and they collapse, it might be in their purse, it might be in their wallet, but if it's not hanging around their neck, they will resuscitate them, take them to the ER, and the ER nurse might discover it in your wallet, and then processes to take you off life support, which takes a day or so. It will happen. But they might do their job because you weren't wearing it, okay? Now, there are also the little bracelets where you can take this and fold it and put it inside the little plastic bracelet, which if you shower, it gets wet. There's no really great system. And I haven't met one person yet that wears this around their neck. But that's the system for following protocol. So they're always going to do too much rather than too little. And then when it is discovered in the ER, take proper steps to remove life support and do what is right by that patient. But just to understand that curious law of how that works in Florida, a little different in other states, but how that works in Florida. So full code, you'll hear that terminology in hospital. You'll hear the a nurse maybe say, this patient's a full code. You're standing there and go, oh, I know what that means. Okay. So there's really two distinctions, full code or DNR. One or the other. I know there are some hospitals that do quasi codes, in between codes, smorgasbord codes, which meaning resuscitate me but don't defibrillate me, or give me open the crash cart and give me those drugs but don't do the CPR, or I've been intubated before and I didn't like that, don't do that. But folks, it might take a package to get you back. It might take everything. So if you go, well, don't do that, then that's what they call maybe a chemical code or a partial code. A lot of hospitals are resisting that, going, do you want to be resuscitated or not? Because what if you weren't breathing and your heart weren't beating, and I did chest compressions, but I didn't breathe for you, and we didn't put you on the ventilator, well, you might not take a breath by yourself. And then they go, well, that's okay by me. Because I just don't ever want to be intubated again. And it's like, but, you know, it's kind of a package deal. But so we see orders sometime, the patient wants this but not that. And I, the patient advocate, would go back to the doctor and go, did you explain to them that it won't work? Let's get this scenario. Let's say I want the crash cart open and give me those drugs in my IV or straight into my heart, but don't do CPR and don't do intubation. And I want to ask, there are some nurses in this room, what if I were to stand over this patient and I didn't perfuse the blood, but I stuck an IV in the arm and started pushing it in? Where would the medicine go?
Nowhere.
Nowhere. So, and then I'm going to bill them for a crash cart. And so I say to the doctors, that's unethical. So it's like we need to give them the full range of understanding what is available. And then you say, well, okay, I want the crash cart, but it won't work. If I just do the crash cart and do the drugs, it won't work. Oh, well, I know. Okay, well, I guess I don't want that, or I guess I don't want it all. So in other words, it's what we call in the medical world, of legal world, informed consent. They're informed of all the options, and they've given consent. So sometimes the information is lacking, so they can't give informed consent because they don't have all the facts. So simply we go back to, here's what is available. Three choices. Do you want to be full code? Do
Do you want to be a DNR with aggressive care, meaning go to the doctor, go to the ER, come to the hospital, take the treatment, whatever you say. When you say stop, we'll say stop. But you want, all you don't want is a DNR. All you don't want is resuscitation. Or the last one is DNR with hospice care. We're not trying to fix it anymore. We're not trying to correct the disease. We might be treating the symptom. We might even be doing dialysis if that takes some pressure off the system. We might even be doing some kind of drug. We might be doing some kind of treatment, but we wouldn't be trying to cure. So you would have a DNR, and you might be on hospice care to treat pain or treat symptoms. So there's really basically three choices to think through. If you kind of boil it down to that, kind of helps simplify what's available. There are several situations you will be in and working with families in which families are suffering. One way, they're suffering because the patient's suffering. Grandma's grimacing, grandma's moaning, grandma's not comfortable, can you give her something? Or, I can't stand to see grandma this way, give me something. We wish we could give family members some medicine sometime, So they're going, give her more, give her more. At a certain point where we don't give too much medication, retard the breathing, that could cause death. So we don't give too much of that, but it's like there's some moment when we're suffering as a family member, or maybe the patient's suffering, and nurses are working with that scenario, trying to help the patient as much as they can and help the families as much as they can. I found this is a great way where chaplains can come in and just be there. Just be by their side. Just be able to hold their hand, give them a hug, and hurt with them, and help them understand they're going to do the best they can by grandma. We're going to take care of her. We're not going to let her suffer. But it hurts us. So love is a good thing that says, I want to care for them. I want them here as long as I can. And as long as they're here, I don't want to see them hurting. Physicians don't normally use the terminology viable life and quality of life. That's more of what family members look at. They're looking at the other terms we talked about before of the diagnosis and the prognosis and reasonable recovery. So if you were to ask a physician, if this were your mother, what would you do? And he or she, the doctor, might tell you. I really think that's an erroneous question because it's not their mother. But it gets asked sometimes. And they go, well, if it was my mother, I'd do this. Because he might want to do heroics, do too much. Or they might say, no, I would just let go. It's an unfair question. Because see, what families are looking at, viable life, is it possible that if we did this, she would get better? And especially for the last child that comes into town that hasn't been there all week, that just flew in, they go, did you try this? Did you do this? I've read this on the internet and all this. Have we done that? Yes, yes, yes. It takes them a while to get ready to let go. Because they need to be sure all those things are done before they can go, okay. It's not a good thing to say it's time to let go, but I guess it's the right thing. So it takes individually that moment of letting go. Is the life viable? Is there quality of life? You see, there's a time when I, as a patient, might say, I never want to be walking down Walmart and pulling that oxygen tank behind me and that thing in my nose. That would be humiliating. Just kill me. But if I'm in ICU on life support for a month and I survive, I may go, I'll take that thing gladly. Might change my mind, right? Especially at my age, I may change my mind in a few years about, oh, maybe I will take that kind of treatment, okay? Patients will change their mind. Surrogates will change their mind as they look at the options and look at the facing of possible death. There's going to be some shifting of opinions and decisions along that way. So understand that's okay if they change their mind. Let's understand this. If I've made out my living will, I can tear up this living will as long as I'm competent. As long as I have the strength to go, change it. I don't want that anymore. I can change my events record. If I have my do not resuscitate order, all that signed, I can say if I have strength and capability, I want to be resuscitated now. If I choose to go on hospice and then I change my mind, I can go off of hospice. until the day I'm incompetent to make another decision. So the last thing you signed, the last thing you said, is what we're stuck with. Okay? So understand, you can change your mind. But your surrogates are supposed to follow your last wishes. They can at some time change their mind because they're asked inappropriate questions, but we need to be careful that we're asking what the patient wants. So the DNR, do not resuscitate order, is not automatic. The day I become terminal, the day I become end stage, the day I become persistent vegetative state or brain dead, as my wife calls me, the day I become that isn't the day automatically my living will becomes a DNR. It's a separate discussion, and sometimes it's not brought up. Sometimes it's just not discussed. When I, as a patient advocate, came in many times ago, have you heard about a DNR and a do not resuscitate order? No, what's that? I mean, they were already in stage, or the patient was already persistent vegetative state. Have you heard about it? No. I thought that took care of the DNR of the advanced directive. No, different. So sometimes just bringing that information up and letting them understand that, that can be the next stage in talking. All right, time for a joke. Husband and wife on the sofa watching TV all night. He was drinking beer all night. He said, honey, if I'm ever existing only by a machine, only alive by a bottle of fluids, then pull the plug. So she got up and unplugged the TV and poured his beer down the sink. I guess that's an advanced directive. Huh? Just what she was hoping for. We've got to have fun with it, don't we? Got to make this a lively moment. Let's talk about hospice care. Not all DNR patients are hospice patients. As we said before, they could be aggressive care patients. They could have a DNR but want treatment. Hospice is for those patients who are letting go, choosing not to try to lick this anymore to fix this. And according to the Medicare rules, it's usually when the doctor pulls out his or her crystal ball and says, in about 6 months, I think they're going to pass. So then they can be on hospice care. Some patients are on hospice care longer because it's the crystal ball. I don't know for sure when they're going to die, but I can't sign them onto hospice care as a doctor unless I think maybe they might pass within 6 months, okay? Because it's going to be a whole different billing system. Medicare is going to be taking care of that through hospice, and so they're a whole different kind of channel of working with that patient. But sometimes, and even many times, patients get a little better when they're on hospice. Let's talk about the patient who was in such excruciating pain that they couldn't eat. Have you ever been in so much pain you didn't want to eat? I haven't had too many of those days. I usually like to eat, okay? But just sometimes you just, I'm so sick, just take the food away. What if that went on for days and days and weeks you couldn't eat and you got really sick, really weak? You couldn't even put your feet on the side of the bed. Now, doctors will not want to cut that pain because they don't want to cause what? Addiction. Okay? So for the well patient or the getting better patient, they go, well, I don't want to give them that much pain medication because there's a hawk watching doctors writing too much pain medication, because then they go to dispensers, that's illegal. So they've got to be careful and always around and not doing too much, so they don't want to get their patients addicted. So when a patient gets on hospice care, they are in a different category of taking care of pain. So they can give them more pain medication, more than they've ever done before. And they might give this patient that is not eating and is in the bed, more pain medication, and it cuts the pain. The pain stops. And they go, can I have some of that Jell-O? How about that sauce over there? That salad looks good. And boy, that steak even looks good. And then they sit on the side of the bed. Then they stand up. Then they walk out of the room. Then they walk down the hallway. And the disease is still there, but they've gotten a little better. And the family goes, whoa, look at Grandpa. He's doing great. Well, but his cancer's still there. The heart problem's still there. The lung problem, the kidney problem, whatever's still there. But they're getting better. So sometimes hospice patients get discharged from hospice because they're not going to die within 6 months. But you'll see them later, and they'll get reinstated in hospice. But some patients get discharged from hospice because they're improving in that kind of a way. There are going to be some ethical situations you come across as a chaplain. You're going to see some situations where
There is lack of communication. I was the chairman of our ethics committee in our hospital for 13 years. What basically you will see in ethical issues are not legal issues, or sometimes not even ethical issues. They're communication problems. One doctor didn't talk to another doctor. One doctor not talking to the family. One family member not talking to another family member. And there's some kind of impasse, some kind of communication breakdown, some kind of feud going on. And so someone goes, let's have an ethics committee. And you bring them all together and they go, oh, is that what you mean? Oh, yeah, I agree with that. It's just getting them together to talk. And isn't that a mayhem? Just think about, remember I said when you're healthy, you have one doctor. When you're sick the last month of your life, you may have one, two, three, four, five doctors. Just think of five doctors who have 10 or more patients in this hospital and 10 or more patients in another hospital and 50 patients back at their doctor's office. And you're taking care of all those. And this one patient changes in their care, and does that doctor email or text or call all the other four doctors? They do their best. Just think of the madness trying to keep up with that many patients. Okay? I'm glad I'm not a doctor. I'm glad I'm not a nurse. But the communication breakdown is quite easy when you have so many doctors, when you have so many players trying to make decisions. And the family member were like, this doctor's not talking to that doctor, and they don't know what's over this, and they just come in and read the chart and blah, 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 and it's like they don't really know what's going on. There might be an ethics committee need just to bring in, just to talk. So sometimes I've had go into ICU and a nurse will stop me, bed 11 and bed 12, both ethical issues, look into that, Larry. And I'm like, okay, we'll look into that. And you kind of see that the family's not really feuding, the doctor, it's like frustration to the nurse. So anybody can call an ethical issue. The ethics team is built with doctors, nurses, respiratory therapists, administration attorneys, even members at large from the community who don't work for the hospital to make them more ethical, okay? So that's the team, that's the ethics committee, and ethics committee in hospitals can deal with accounting problems, employee problems, but they don't normally. They normally deal with bioethical issues, end-of-life issues. So if you were on an ethics committee, you would mainly hear about, we're talking about moving this patient from life support, and there's a situation going on, and family this, and doctor this, and nurse this, and so it's more of those kind of issues. When do you, as a volunteer chaplain, advocate for that patient? You can stomp your feet, you can call for help when you think there's some kind of impasse, some kind of ethical issue, some kind of legal issue, and you might ask the family members, did you know that there was an ethics committee here in our hospital that can be convened on your behalf just to talk this through? No, I didn't know there was. Would you like me to find out who that person is who runs that and get an ethics committee for you? So you as a chaplain or a doctor, a nurse, respiratory therapist, administration, patient, surrogate, family, anybody can call for the ethics committee. So anybody can say, whoa, we need some information here, we need some help here. So it doesn't have to be a cut and dry legal issue or ethical issue. It's just some kind of communication impasse to bring that together. Then a team will come and look at that chart, usually a team that's not on the case, different than the nurse, different than the doctor, different than the respiratory, someone's not on the case, looking at it. And this team is not legislative. They will not say to a doctor, doctor, you will do this. Nurse, you will do this. Family, patient, this is what we're going to do. They're not legislative. But they gather information and maybe suggest another consult, or to be legal, we need to do this, this, and this first, and then display here, what do you want us to do? And usually that's all it takes. It's just the information state. So usually, who do you call for that? If you don't know who that ethics chairperson is, call the chief nursing officer, a quality manager, risk manager, the nurse that's taking care of the patient might know. Administration might know, just somebody to say, I don't know who to call to get this thing going, and you can move ahead with that. Here are some excuses that I hear of not filling out an advance directive. I've heard hundreds. Here are a few that I've heard of. I'm not that sick. Why would I need to fill out an advance directive? I'm not. Grandma needs one. I don't need one. Or I'm only 39 years old. Why would I need something like that? Yeah. And I would say anybody that's married, responsible for somebody else, if they are going to be responsible for you someday, then you need to make up your wishes, what your advance directive is, so they don't happen. I think it's the most loving thing you can do for your family to get that done. It takes the pressure off them to have to make that decision.
And then there's those who say, well, I'm only having toe surgery. What do I need that for? I'm coming in here for this non-stitch cataract surgery. My doctor told me it's safe. And you understand that every patient comes in our hospital as an inpatient, we have to ask them, do you have an advanced directive? Joint Commission makes us ask them. So here they're having a simple surgery. Their doctor promotes it, oh, it's no big deal. First question is, do you have an advanced directive? What? What, are you kidding me? Scare the pants off them. But we have to ask. Now, we don't have to make them have one, but we have to ask, do you have one? And if you do have one, can you give us a copy of that and we'll keep it in a chart? Why are you keeping it in my chart for? Because they make us, you know. You know, it's just going to collect dust until that one day when you can't get better, but Joint Commission makes us have a copy. So it's like scares them to death why we need to do all that. And so we'll give you a blank one if you don't have one, but you don't have to fill it out, but we'll give you one if you don't have one for free because we're trying to promote it's good for people. But it scares the patients coming in for surgery or whatever procedure. Then they say it's a bad omen. I have met someone who bought life insurance on Monday and died on Tuesday. And I know if I fill this thing out, I'm dying tomorrow. Well, it doesn't cause it, but I'm glad the person who bought life insurance on Monday bought on Monday and not on Wednesday, right? But it didn't cause it, but I've seen them shake as they're signing their advance. You know, what are you going to do with this? Nothing. I'm just going to collect dust. Not going to do anything about it at all until many, many years later. And then the person says, I want to be in control. I don't want to fill out an advance directive and put these two people in control. I want to be in control. Well, what if you're anoxic? What if you just came out of surgery? Or if you're incapacitated? What if you can't? Well, I'm not giving anybody any control over me. I want to be. The best way you can be in control, fill out the advance directive right now and name the two people you want instead of us appointing that grandson of yours that you don't like. To pull the plug.
Oh, okay.
So you are in control, making the event. But the most favorite excuse I've heard, I was at a health fair, and I was giving out blank advance directive, and this one lady passed by the wheel and go, would you like an advance directive? No, thank you. I haven't had a heart attack in years. Denial, huh? So it's those kind of things that keep us from making out. Now I ask you, do you have your advance directive? Have you made those determinations? Do you have it signed? Have you given copies to your doctor? Have you given copies to your family members? Have you discussed it so they know exactly what you want? I have checked your county statistics. I know that the death rate is one per person. Nobody's going to get out of this life alive. Everybody needs one except for the person way out in the boonies in the woods and nobody could get to them and you're probably going to be resuscitated. So what are they going to do for you that you maybe don't want that you could spell out in advance directive? This last site here, write this down or you've got it on your hand out there. If you just want to go to your website and know the Florida laws, it tells the laws of every state. So you might live or have people that live in different states. So just go to that website and you'll look at your state name and you'll go to that site and then you can find out more information about advance directives here in Florida or in any state of the country. Understand that in a hospital, if I come into this hospital and I don't have an advance directive from Florida, but I have one even from Germany, Florida will honor any advance directive. That might not be true of other states. So you might have a Florida advance directive, and you might move or visit in another state, and they might not recognize it because it wasn't done their way. Florida tries to bend over backwards to do it so that we can meet patient wishes, but some states are a little peculiar in that. They do it a little differently. We're going to take a break now. Any questions that you have?